speedily and holistically. That what it takes for prayer to be answered by fire. That means the answer will come speedily. Not only that, the situation will be completely dealt with. Why? Because when fire burns, it burns completely. So it consumes completely. Like when Elijah said, if I be man of God, let the fire come and consume the captain of 50. All the entire 50 captain were consumed completely. None of them escaped. None of them escaped. So when fire burns, it burns completely. When fire burns, it burns out completely. So when your prayer is answered by fire, number one, your answer will come speedily. Number two, the situation will be holistically handled to be totally solved. That's what it takes for God to answer your prayer by answer. When fire burns to consume, it does not leave anything behind. The matter will be solved totally. I remember the day God healed me of an ulcer. It was a very terrible pain. I went to bed with pain. Overnight, I saw myself being opened up. And I saw a hand enter into me. I woke up, oh. Ulcer disappear. This is me that when I'm talking, my mouth will be smelling like latrine. You know, when I bash, it will be, you know, the smell will be like horrible latrine. A terrible latrine. Everything was so terrible. But one night, I woke up and ulcer disappeared completely. So when your prayer is answered by fire, it will be answered speedily and the matter will be solved completely. I remember when I little got married to my wife, she had one terrible blood like that. And I said to her, the day my blood touches your blood group will change. After our first meeting, our blood will change till today. So when God answered by fire, the answer comes speedily and the problem is solved completely. I prophesy to everyone under the sound of my voice here tonight. May God answer your prayer by fire. May your prayer be answered by fire. I said, may your prayer be answered by fire. What it takes that your prayer will be answered speedily, and that matter will be solved completely. In the mighty name of Jesus. Now, what are the keys that makes your prayer to be answered by fire? Keys that make God to answer by fire. Things that provoke God to answer by fire. Things that provoke God to answer by fire. Number one thing you must know is that have a lifestyle of worship. Learn how to worship God and also have a lifestyle of worship. There are two different things. One thing is to know how to worship God, and that is to have a lifestyle of worship. A lifestyle of worship is a life consecrated and totally dedicated to God. That's a lifestyle. That is how you can somebody who is a worshiper but a terrible sinner. His life is not consecrated. He was just exhibiting and demonstrating talent. He's a worshiper but does not have a lifestyle of worship. Why? Because in the book of Romans chapter 12 verse 2. 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 Who is reading for us? Who is the man in multimedia that is showing my picture instead of showing the scripture? Can you please clap for the man in multimedia who is showing my picture instead of showing the scripture? Okay. And be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Go to verse 3. Go to verse 3. For I say truly. No, go back to that verse 2. Now go to another version. The will of God is talking about a reasonable, pleasing, and perfect will of God. Now go to verse 1. Quickly go to verse 1. Let's start reading from verse 1. Let's read. Say, therefore, I urge you, brethren, in view of God's mercy, to offer your body as a living sacrifice, only pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. Can you see now? Another word for art is lifestyle. Art of worship. So therefore, I urge you, brethren, in view of God's mercy, to offer your this as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. Another pastor call it a reasonable service, an acceptable act of worship. So your spiritual act of what? Worship. It's not enough to sing with a sonorous voice, but for you to live a dedicated, a sacrificial, a life of wholeness, a life of holiness. Giving your body to God, because not giving your body to sink and now give your body to immorality. When you are like that, you know, like I said to us in one of my teachings here, that we are mobile temple of the living God. Even though the temple built by God can be very big, but God said it does not dwell in the temple built with hand. That notwithstanding, he has chosen to make your body his temple, where it dwells. He said our body is the temple of the living God. Even the one built in Jerusalem, God said he cannot dwell in the house built with hand. And yet, as tiny as you are, he makes you as his temple. For God to dwell in you, the one that has a fire cannot be dwelling in you, and your case will not be solved. That's the number one thing you must know. If you want to live a daily victorious life with your prayer being answered by fire, you must have a lifestyle of worship. You must also be a worshiper. You saw it's enough to learn how to worship God. Then learn how to have lifestyle of worship. Lifestyle of what? Of worship. Let them be a living, only sacrifice. They can't, he will find acceptable. This is truly the way to worship him. Can you sit down? Look at this NLT. And so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because of all he has done for you. Let them be what? A living and only sacrifice to the kind he will find acceptable. I also say, if God does not accept your personality, whatever you offer God will be rejected. So the first thing is that let your person be accepted. Say, so let it be a living and only the kind he will find acceptable. Now I said, this is truly the way to worship him. That means the true way to worship God is not to come to the altar here and begin to sing. And sing and sing. No. The true way to worship is for your life to be pleasing and acceptable to God. That's the true way to worship. That's the true way to worship. You know, worship and praise is the food of God. God does not eat amala. He doesn't eat ikokore. He doesn't eat all manner of delicacy we have in Africa. But in the both intercontinental dish or whatever dish you call about. But one thing he feeds on is praise. But may I tell you something? Can you prepare a very wonderful delicacy? Very delicious food. And you see poo all over your body. All over your body. Shit all over your body. You now carry a very delicious food with aroma that is almost killing. Carry in his hand and present to somebody. Will he collect it from your hand? Why? Because the carrier of the delicious food is what? That is where how we have most time. When your life is not acceptable to God and you are worshiping God and you are singing and your life, if your personality is not accepted, whatever you offer God will be rejected. So note that. So when you are rejected, everything you carry is rejected. So please note that. So your life cannot be unaccepted to God. Say, let your life be the kind that we find acceptable. So that whatever. Do you know what happened? God did not only reject the sacrifice of Cain, he rejected the person of Cain. Why? Because Cain did not have the right mindset. He has a bad attitude. Bible says, and God rejected Cain and his sacrifice. If your personality is rejected, your sacrifice will never be acceptable. Will not be acceptable. So please note that is very, very important. If you must live a life with an answer, with prayer, be answered by fire. Number two that you must know is that you must learn how forgive. You must learn how to forgive. Matthew chapter 6 verse 12 says, and forgive us our debt, and as we forgive our debtors. Can you go there? And forgive us our sin as we have. Why are you changing now? Maybe you need a little bit translation. And forgive us our sins as we have forgiven those who sin against us. Do not ignore this statement. Say, just the same way I forgive others is the same way you must forgive me. Meaning that if my forgiving my fellow brother is a partial forgiveness, so you also give me a partial forgiveness. So forgive us our sins as we are forgiven. That means it's the same measure you use for others that God will also use for you in return. Please know that. Forgive us our sin as exactly the way. Do not know that. Do unto my life the way I do to my neighbor. So if your forgiveness is not total, you can be sure that God's forgiveness towards your life will never be total. We have many young people who are bitter about the way their parents have treated them, who have found it difficult to forgive in their heart. Some cannot forgive their mother, their father. When you are like that, your prayer will not be answered speedily, and your case will not be done or undone totally in the sight of God. Two things happen. When your prayer is answered by fire, it will be speedily and it will be total, holistical. So if you want your case to be total, then let your forgiveness be total. We have wives who have not forgiven husband not forgiving wives, holding grudges. Then you'll be hindering your prayer being answered speedily and totally. That is answered by fire. So forgive us our sins as we are forgiving those who sin against us. Matthew chapter 6, verse 14 to 15. Matthew 6, 14 to 15. For if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father. Are you there? If you forgive those who sin against you, your heavenly Father will forgive you. That means if you fail to forgive them, he will not also forgive you. Kud. Go to verse 15. Go to verse 15. But if you refuse to forgive others, your Father will not forgive you your sins. The word sins there is plural. If you refuse, then you have just brought your destiny to a corner. You have just shoot yourself with AK-47 on your two legs. You know, nothing can be so frustrating to pray and nothing is happening in your life. There are issues in our lives, unsettled issues that we carry about every day with our wrapper, with our hair tie, with our suit. Unresolved issues with our neighbors. Even in the church, you see choir fighting another choir. You see a department fighting another department. In this church, I remember it, I was settling issue with a particular department in the church. I had to prostrate, begging a brother not to be fighting again inside the church. And I told them, if I use the honor of God upon my life to prostrate for you, and you are still very adamant, your life is in danger. Because apart from that, I'm older than you. I use the oil of God upon my life to prostrate. I went to his house to prostrate. I brought them to my office to prostrate inside church. So if that can happen inside the church, what is happening outside the church? All resolve issues. I don't like the way he talked to me. I will never greet him again inside church. That's one of the easiest ways to chase away Holy Spirit. Is to have a congregation of unforgiving people. You are just on your own. Church will turn to social club, clubhouse. Nothing happens. Church of God, gate of heaven will be shut against. So I don't like the way he talked to me in the last rehearsal. I beg to hell with him. We are not made, even not for church. Imagine that. That kind of terrible statement. Are we made? It's not your fault. Religion is for whose fault? Is that your fault? Meaning that probably if I've got to marry, I am already bigger than this. You will be talking to me like that. That is not, it's not your fault. You get my point now? Say, so it's not your fault. A vehicle. Yeah, attack of language. So if you refuse to forgive others, your father will not forgive you. And when you carry load of sin on your head, you are carrying a body, eternal body on your life. So please, let's live a life of letting go. It's very, very important. Mark chapter 11, verse 25. Mark 11, 25. And whenever you stand praying, look at it. But when you are praying, first forgive anyone you are holding a grudge against. Everybody read together. One, two, go. And when you are praying, first forgive anyone you are holding a grudge against, so that your father in heaven will forgive you your sins too. Some people come to church with barriers to their answered prayer. Unresolved issues. So don't ask God anything. If you have not done justice to issues going on in your mind. It's very, very important. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 32. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 32. And be kind to one another. Tender hearted. Look at Ephesians 42. He said, instead, be kind to each other. Tender hearted. Forgive you one another. Just as God, through Christ, has forgiven you. Please, these are things that will make your prayers to be answered by fire. Another point I give you quickly. Lead a life of purity and holiness. The prayer of a sinner is an abomination to the Lord. Proverbs 15:8 said, the sacrifice of the wicked is an abomination to the Lord. Said, but the prayer of the upright is his delight. That means God is always delighted when you are praying to him, when you are the righteous type. The Lord detests the sacrifice of the wicked. The sacrifice of the wicked is an abomination to the law, but the prayer of the upright is his delight. That means God is happy, is delighted. If you go to New Living Translation, New Living Translation, New Living Translation, he said the Lord detests the sacrifice of the wicked, but he delights in the prayers of the what? Of the upright. God is delighted. He's always willing to hear you talking to him. Yes, he found a delight in listening to your petition. And when he's happy, he's delighted, you can be sure that he will give you an answer speedily. It's a comforting thing to him when your life is right. Please go with me to the book of Psalm 66, 18 to 20. Psalm 66, 18 to 20. Psalm 66. 18 to 20. Am I there? If I had not confessing in my heart, the Lord would not have listened. Look at it. Would not have what? Listen. Another one says, if I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear. Look at verse 19. Say, but certainly God has heard me. He has attended to the voice of my prayers. That means he did not have any iniquity, but God did listen. But God did listen. But God did what? Listen. But certainly God has heard me. He has attended to the voice of my prayer. He has attended. Even before he was talking here. So please, no wonder David pleaded for mercy when he committed the sin of adultery against Bathsheba. Let me tell you something today. I was studying yesterday. And this issue of, I want to tell you something today. As one of the major key to run away from sin. And listen to me very carefully. If you are the type that is very, very slothful and hide-do. You become a tool in the hand of the devil. You are a devil's workshop. Devil use you mostly when you are idle. Do you know what led to the sin that David committed against Bathsheba? The Bible says in this book of 2 Samuel, he said, it's at this time, the kings always go to war. That means at the time he committed that sin, he shouldn't have been at all. He should be the war front. But at that time, as a king, he was not meant to be at all. That means if he had gone for that war, that sin, he would not have committed. So at the cool of the day, he was walking on his balcony and he saw a woman taking a bath. And the beauty of that woman was irresistible one. It was so beautiful that he cannot resist it. David, there are some sin, no matter your anointing. Bibles that says, occupy till I come, knows what he's talking about. Don't let your arm be idle, because devil will take advantage of you. That's what the Bible says. He that lays hand on the plow and look back is not fit for the kingdom. Because devil is always there. Your life cannot be idle. It's either you are useful or devil is using you. Two ways. There is no vacuum in life. Please, I beg of us. It was at the time he could have been engaged with the things of God. But he was not there. We call it the peri of comfort. You know, he has become a king now. And he cannot sit back in the palace while he sent his boys to the war front. But unfortunately, that particular sin makes Saul never to leave his family. Even though God forgave him that sin, he said, but Saul will never depart from his family. It's a terrible thing. He said, in the public, what you did to this woman in the secret will be done to your own wife in the public place. Say, your own is secret now, but I will make the molestation of our life open. Though God has forgiven, but the repercussion was very severe. Please, I beg of you. So if you want your prayer to be answered speedily, always also plead for mercy. That's why David wrote Psalm 51, reading from verse 1 to 9. Say, have mercy upon me. In Psalm 51, after he had committed sin, have mercy upon me, O God, according to your loving kindness, according to the multitude of your tender mercies. Blot out my transgression, wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sins. Always plead for God's mercy. You never can tell. It is a mistake to say you don't make a mistake. What do I say? Aha. So please, maybe you look where you're supposed not to look, and you touch where you're supposed not to touch, or you talk where you're supposed not to talk, and you did not talk where you're supposed to talk. There are a lot of things. There are sins of transgression, breaking rules and regulations. They say, stay here. Nobody run on another man's lane and win the race of life. When you cross the track, you are disqualified because you have broken the rules. There are a lot of things that qualify your prayer from being answered in the journey of life. So we call it transgression, breaking rules and regulations. Breaking the rule of marriage. Do you know that if you break the rule of soups, you will not enjoy the soup? Break the rule of soup, a goosey soup. It will go sour. Don't warm it. We're supposed to warm it. Leave it. You will enjoy it. You will enjoy your life when you're a rule breaker. Ordinary soup has its own rule. If you break the rule, you will not enjoy the soup. A lie. So those who are rule breakers don't enjoy the best out of life. So please, I beg of you, be always willing to plead for God's mercy. The only thing that gives a sinner access is his blood. Always plead for his mercy. Look at the publican did in the book of Luke chapter 18. Don't be full of yourself. Don't be boastful in the sight of God. See yourself as no man. Because when man stands side by side with a righteous God, you are an evil person. You can't stand by the side of the holiest God and be claiming righteousness. Why? Because all unrighteousness is a sin. And all our righteousness are just like a filthy rag. Because we don't have any righteousness of our own. If God should begin to mark iniquity, who will stand? Who will stand? So all our righteousness are just like a filthy rag in the sight of God. So when you are with God, don't claim holier than thou, otherwise you will go back condemned. So just plead for his mercy in the place of prayer. Because if a man should stand side by side with the righteous God, man will be an evil person. So because all our righteousness put together are what? Filthy rag. Look at Luke chapter 18, verse 13 to 14. If you are going to boast at all, boast in the Lord. Don't do any bragging when you are standing before the Almighty God. Just plead for his mercy. So, and the tax collector standing afar off will not so much as raise his eyes to heaven, but beat his heart, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. He recognized. But before this prayer, if you go to verse 12, you will see the case of a Pharisee who was just boasting. See, I fast twice a day, a week. He was not telling that, he was actually fasting. So if I fast twice a week, does that make you more holier than God? Not only that, I give tithe of all that I possess. Fine. God is not disputing that, but you are arrogant. Because what you are claiming that you are giving, you are not even the owner in the first place. Bible says, what do you have that God has not given to you? How can you be boasting on what belongs to God that he gave you part? You not gave it back to the original owner, you are boasting. Say, what do you have that God has not given to you? That you give God 10% and you are not boasting in the sight of God who wants the entire 100%. So that's why you don't have anything. That to say, God, have mercy on me. That you pray for mercy does not give you license to be committing sin. For in the book of Romans, chapter 6, verse 1, says, shall we continue in sin? That grace may abound. Say, God forbid. Romans 6, verse 1. Say, what shall we say there? Shall we continue in sin? That grace may abound. Go to the next verse. He said, God, certainly not. How shall we who died to sin live any longer in it? Certainly not. And that verse says, God forbid it. Those who appreciate heresies all over the places, once saved, is forever safe. Heresies of the highest order. That message is from the pit of hell. Once saved, is forever safe. You can be living careless life now. Christ has died for you. Therefore, rubbish your body. Nothing will happen. Please, I beg of us. So another thing that gives you speedy answer is your word. Is the blood of Jesus. In Revelation chapter 12, verse 11, he said, they overcame it by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. Always plead the blood. There is one thing the devil cannot withstand when he sees his blood. It's a powerful weapon. Even in heaven, it was the same weapon that they used to defeat the devil. There was a battle in heaven. There was a war in heaven. And what they used to conquer the devil in heaven before he was changed to this earth was the blood. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb. So when the blood is pleaded, something great happened. So when you are praying, don't forget to include the blood. Plead the blood on your prayer. It's a tool to overcome any challenge, any circumstance of life. Another thing is your word of testimony. And the word of their testimony. That was exactly what David used when he said in 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 37. He said, moreover, David said, the Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear. He will deliver me from the hand of this Philistine. Testimony. He testified to the goodness of the past and he conquered the war of the present. Say after me. He testified to the goodness of the past and he conquered the world of the present. Say after me. He testified to God's goodness of the past and he conquered the war of the present. So the word of your testimony that the Lord who saw me through elementary school will see me through secondary school. The Lord who saw me through secondary school will see me through my tertiary institution or education. The Lord who saw me through at social time will also see me through again. Testify to the name of the Lord and to the goodness of God. Your word of testimony. Then pray in the Holy Ghost. Pray in the Holy Ghost. Romans chapter 8, verse 26 to 27. Learn to pray in the Holy Ghost. If you have not been baptized with the Spirit of with the Holy Spirit, you are just a social member of the church. Not a spiritual member. What do I call you? Member of the church. Not a what? A spiritual member. Ask your neighbor, are you a social member or a spiritual member? Ask your neighbor, are you a social member of the church or a spiritual member? He said, I'm telling you tonight, hear me very well. Say, I'm telling you tonight, if you have not received baptism of the Holy Spirit, you are a social member, not a spiritual member of the church. What is social member? When you relate, that is social life. Now you're coming to church socially, not spiritually. For you to stop being a social member of the church or of the body of Christ, you must receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. One of the Sundays we are planning, we're going to organize the baptism of the Holy Spirit for every member of the church. But you cannot hold grudges in your heart and Holy Spirit will dwell in you. He will just come and go. Like Old Testament experience. Romans chapter 8, verse 26 to 27. Romans 8. Say, likewise the Spirit also help in our weakness. This man, stop changing this when I start reading already. Romans 8:26. Likewise the Spirit also helps in our weakness. For we do not know what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit himself make intercession for us with groaning which cannot be uttered. Do you know the meaning of that? When you pray in the Spirit, Holy Spirit will take your prayer to a level you can never get to, that you can never explain. Many of us don't know how to pray, but when Holy Spirit takes over to intercede for us, it will take you your prayer to a dimension you can never get to. That is a level you can't get to in the place of prayer that it takes the Holy Spirit to get there. I'm going to stop there tonight because of time. There is a particular dimension you can never reach in the place of prayer that it takes the Holy Spirit to get to that dimension. So there is a particular limit you can only get to in the place of prayer. That is why you need Holy Spirit. He said, I will not leave you without a comforter. Say, as I go, I will send you a comforter who will teach you what things, I will remind you what things. A comforter is our intercessor, is our executor, is an implementer of whatever God wants to do in our lives. So that's why the Bible says, give now the Spirit with which you were sealed to the day of redemption. That is a seal. A seal is an approver. Until the Spirit of the Lord is involved, your prayer is not approved. So, likewise, the Spirit also help us. What is the meaning of help? Help is making you to do what you not have been able to do as a person. If you can do it, you don't need help. So why it's coming is to continue where you stopped. Where your strength terminates is where the Holy Spirit takes over in the place of prayer. Rise up on your feet. That is a limit you can get to with your strength. Where your strength stops, that is where Holy Spirit takes over. When your strength has been exhausted in the place of prayer, the Holy Spirit takes over from there. Say, likewise, the Spirit also helps in our weakness. For we do not know what we should pray for. Let me read it for you to know. Many a time, you know what he does? He will sieve this your prayer point. There are some prayer you pray that you are even praying against your life. Let me also tell you, no, many a time, when you are saying your enemy should die, you are even the enemy that's supposed to die. Because you are the one undoing yourself ignorantly. So if not for the involvement of the Spirit, you will have used your own prayer to kill yourself. You are not getting the message. Many a time you use your mouth to dig your grave. Because you don't know. You are acting in ignorance. Look at what he says. Likewise, the Spirit also helps our weakness. For we do not know what we should pray for as we ought to. But the Spirit himself make intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. Go to the next verse. Look at it here. Now, he who searches the heart knows what the might of the Spirit is, because he makes intercession for the saints according to the will of God, not according to your will. Let me give you an instance. You saw a man who is giving you some money to cook soup, and you say it's clearly, and you bring it to the month, end of the month prayer. Every embargo that will not allow my husband, this man, to marry me, remove it. We are at the man you are praying over is not the will of God for your life. All this will just say, useless girl. He will just help you to scatter the prayer. Because he will see it. He knows the will of God for your life. That person you are praying for. There are many disappointments in your life that is caused by the Holy Spirit. Because you don't even know what you should pray for. Many times it is what will kill you that you are praying for. Give me this thing. Give me this thing. Holy Spirit is our helper. He's like a child who has not grown to a level. Asking the father to go and buy him a limousine car. That boy will kill himself. When he has not grown into that height, yet he wants it. That's how many of you are in the place of, in the sight of God. Many things you want to go for, but you have not grown for it. You have to grow into it, not to go into it. Many things you want to go into, you are asking for marriage. Marital breakthrough. What do you know about marriage? Nothing. Have you read any book about marriage? Nothing. And yet you just walk over. Give me a husband. No, 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 no. Husband, 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 husband. Husband will come now. Now you go use Wahala. Chase him away. Character. Wife, 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 wife. She there, she there, she there. Have you not seen a woman that is very naggy over his children? You did children. You don't go kill me. Nobody asked for him. Who asked for her? Not you. So when you say some things, so what am I saying? Holy Spirit is our helper in the place of prayer. He will save your prayer and ensure that your prayer is answered in accordance with the will of God. Because many times you don't know what to pray for. Many times you pray for something that will kill you. And you say that you give it to me or I die. God will say, you will not die, but I won't give it to you. Because this thing, you don't need it. Many times, what you want is not what you need. There's a difference between want and need. And Bible says, give us this day our daily bread. Eh? God gives you what you need, not what you want. Because what you want can kill you. What you need will sustain you. Lift up your hands unto the Lord. I continue from where I stop next week. Lift up your hands unto the Lord. Say, Lord Jesus, I need your Spirit in my life more than ever before. The Spirit that will help me to pray in accordance with your Spirit. The Spirit that will help me to pray beyond my limit. Father, I release that Spirit. Fill me with your Spirit in the mighty name of Jesus. Open your mouth and pray. Open your mouth and pray. Open your mouth and pray to God. Open your mouth and pray to God. Open your mouth and pray to God. In Jesus' name, we pray. In Jesus' name, we pray. 2 Kings chapter 1 verse 9 said that the king sent to him a captain of 50 with his 50 men. Now listen to me now. There are some power that are very desperate to bring you down. Want to pray just one prayer tonight before we go. They are very desperate. If they apply the first approach, they couldn't succeed. They will go for the second approach. They will go for the third one. Very desperate. When Elijah was to be arrested, the king sent captain of 50 with his men to go arrest him. And the king sent to him a captain of 50 with his 50 men. So he went up to him, and there he was sitting on the top of the hill. And he spoke to him, man of God. The king has said, come down. Everybody that said you should come down, they will go down for you to rise. So Elijah answered and said to the captain of 50, if I am a man of God, let the fire come down from heaven and consume you and your 50 men. And the fire came down from heaven and consumed him and his 50. By the time I continue with you next week, I will tell you all that thing that will make fire to fall. I didn't reach there this evening. I only do some foundation tonight. By next Wednesday, I will go a step further. But we are going to pray a prayer tonight. Know there are some forces in life who are very desperate. If they send a first attack, they couldn't succeed. They will relaunch another attack. If they couldn't succeed, they will relaunch another attack. You can imagine. They can decide to waste destiny because they want to waste one person. The king sent captain of 50 with his men. Elijah said, fire should fall and roast them. Fire fell and roast the 50, captain of 50 and their men. The king sent another captain of 50 with their men. Again, roasted. He now sent another captain of 50 with their men. The third batch were wise enough to plead for mercy because they want their life. Please, don't let us die like the first two set of 50. Let me tell you something now. That king, because he was desperate to bring Elijah down, did not mind to be wasting life. You are not getting the message. He was just wasting life. Do not even know that. If the third set of 50 had not pleaded for their life, he would have wasted them and since sent another captain of 50. That means their power that is so desperate to bring you down. May the fire of God consume tonight. It's you that is not desperate about your life. It's you that is casual. Look at that brother now. Look at Solomon now. He's doing a riaza. He's turned his back. Go against the altar. Look at that. So casual. There are power that are desperate. It's you that is looking away. You just be there. Many a time be talking at the back. I've already watched you every Wednesday. The day God go cast you there, that day is coming. Now listen. Lift up your left hand. I cry to God. Every power that is desperate to bring my life down, may the fire of God fall. Let your fire fall on their life. Every power that is desperate, they can lose anything to bring destiny down. They can lose anything to bring glory down. Every power that is desperate to scatter my marriage. Every desperate power to destroy my destiny. Let your fire fall tonight. Open your mouth and pray. Let your fire fall. Let your fire fall and consume them. Let your fire fall and consume them. Every power that is desperate to bring me down. Let your fire fall. 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 Rekele debo patu santa kaladabo. Every desperate power working against my life, let your fire fall and consume them. Rikada poto posata kali ibayada. Rakaladabo ma poto setekele. Makata posokolege.
In
Jesus' name, we pray.
Amen.
Change your position. When it's time to make you to pray, it's still that part that is able to ruin your life. They will allow you to come to church and not take anything out of church. They are desperate to ruin your destiny. They will allow you to leave your house, take Okada, and come to church, and they still waste your time in God's presence. I don't say you should go back. Come to the front. I don't want to chase you away from the altar. I'll pursue you. Everybody, come to the front. In Jesus' name. Your life must get better. I was encouraged in the course of the week when people were coming to my house, coming to share big testimony of what God did in our last prayer time. Why can you leave your house and come to church to come and be playing? You're a foolish person. Come on, you take a kind of pep. You carry your bike. You say you are coming to church and you lift up without anything. Then that means you are just a social person. You are not a spiritual person. If you are spiritual, you should know that a time spent in God's presence should add value to your destiny. It is a social gathering you go to and come and be smiling, weeping. When you carry Bible and paper in your hand, play with children. It's your age. No sense of purpose. Why are you in church? Just come and fool around. You are going to pray. Those powers that are desperate are still the one make you to come to church aimlessly. No full ambition. Just come to church. Some even come to church. No Bible in their hand. No jota, no Bible. They just. I'm going to church. To go and do what? This is not a social club. It's a spiritual house. He entered into the temple and he chased away with whip those who are buying and selling the temple. Who are those people? Those who are in the temple don't have anything to do with the temple. He chased them away. He said, my house, my father's house is not a den of robber, money changer. It's a place of prayer. What do I call it? A place of prayer. A place of purpose. A place where destiny is being molded. Not a place to fool around. He overturned the table of destiny of money changer. He chased away those who are buying dove. If I should explain that scripture to you, do you know what they did? They were selling dove in the temple. What is it mean that? They were exchanging Holy Spirit with social spirit. They were spending social to spirituality. You are not getting the message. Exchanging social for spirituality. Just flick hand. Jesus chased them away. Said, the house of my father shall be called the house of prayer. A place of spiritual where destinies are made. Not a place of disco. That's it. Lift up your altar. Every power that is desperate to bring me down. Let your fire fall.
And
consume them tonight. Open your mouth and pray. Every power that is desperate. Let your fire fall. Your destiny will not be wasted to fight. In the course of trying to bring Elijah down, the first captain of 50 lives were wasted. If you are too casual, you become a casualty.
Amen.
I consume them.
Amen.
I consume them.
Amen.
Every scatter. part that want to bring down your glory. Every part that says you will never succeed. Every part that says you will not get married. You will not get job. You will not settle down. Let your fire fall.
Amen.
And consume them.
Amen.
And consume them.
Amen.
And consume them.
Amen.
And consume them.
Amen.
In the name of the Father.
Amen.
And of the Son.
Amen.
And of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Listen to me. As you go, hear this word. Keep praying that prayer. Everyone that is desperate to bring me down, let your fire fall and roast them and consume them. And you will consume them in Jesus' name. Pack your offering. My time is fast spent. As we listen to the following announcement before we share the grace. Lift it up unto the Lord as we pray. That Father, this is the token of my love for you. Satisfy it. Bless it. Let it be used for your glory. Let it add value to my life. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Thank you, King of Glory, for high prayer in Jesus' name. Ushers, please go around with your basket. There is an account number on the screen. If you don't have a cash here, you can forward it to the account number. Waiting without wasting. Say it louder. Waiting without wasting. Start this Sunday, June 13th, 2021. Time 7:15 and 9:15 a.m. And on Monday, you start by 4 p.m. Waiting without wasting. The singles of purpose. In the house, shout a believing hallelujah. Evangelism hold this Saturday by 8 a.m. Please bear it in mind. And vacancies exist in all the departments of the church. The best way to free your life from sin is to be occupied till it comes. When you are not occupied, devil will occupy you. Be occupied for God. So I don't become a tool in the hand of the devil. And God will bless you in Jesus' name. Come this Thursday, our prayer school is starting while we are still believing government to change their curfew, whatever, or ban. What is the time? This, 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. by Thursday, that is tomorrow, 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. Further notice. And Kaduna Prayer Day comes up on the 16th of June 2021 by 2 p.m. at RCCG Revelation Tower, opposite NPC quarters, Apostle or Prophet Ebuba will be physically available. He has been going around the state to do the same. So all Kaduna, all denomination in Kaduna, will gather in one of our parishes, that is the provincial headquarters of Kaduna Province 4, opposite NIPC quarters, Revelation Tower, by 2 p.m. on 16th of June. Let us gather to pray for this nation. He that love the that love Jerusalem, when you love the prospect of Jerusalem, you will prosper in all of your life. If you want the good of Jerusalem, you see your life prospering. God bless you in the mighty name of Jesus. Shall we wave our hands unto the Lord? Sorry, I've taken more of your time tonight. Let's believe that. Look for someone that you have never met before as we're about sharing the grace and share with them. Ask of their name.